or such powers, you know. It should be the committee. The job of the chairman of the audit committee is to run the audit committee, to ensure efficiency and effectiveness of the audit committees, such as, just as the role of the chairman should be to ensure efficiency and effectiveness of the board. Requirement to attend board meetings, this requirement is continuing from 2002 code. The CFO and company secretary shall attend all meetings of the board except such part of this. It's the same requirement, but my only comment is this is a unique requirement to Pakistan code. Again, I have not seen it anywhere else. It's very interesting. I don't know what is the experience, what is the empirical evidence, whether it has helped. Probably the rationale was that CFO, usually coming from the profession, a chartered accountant or other person, if he's sitting in all board meetings, he will ensure that, you know, the right thing is being done, or he will put his voice if there is some, you know, unusual thing is done or things like that, or unethical thing is done. I don't know. That may be the spirit, but it is unique to Pakistan, and I have not seen any empirical evidence that whether it has really helped. Another interesting requirement, which is continuing from the 2002 code, which should have been modified, is this requirement for the board to report that the system of internal control is sound in design and has been effectively implemented and monitored. Now, it's something, there's no change from 2002 code, but I remember I had held, when this requirement came, I had discussions with Mr. Khalid Mirza at that time, and I had convinced them that this is a very unrealistic requirement. It is like introducing Sarbanes-Oxley Act 2404 provision, audit of internal control, or, you know, because there, only requirement, such requirement is in section 404 of Sarbanes-Oxley Act, where the management has to give a statement that internal control is effective, and the auditors have to audit it. Here there is a requirement for board to give that statement, but without any audit, without even requiring any review. I think this statement on internal control is there in the combined code in UK, and it was introduced in 99 combined code. But the requirement in UK is very interesting. The UK code requires that the board is required to carry out a review of internal control and then report to the shareholders that they've done so. That's all. They're not required to state that internal control is effective and sound in design. Now, why is that so? The reason is that, first of all, internal control is a continuous process. And then you require a framework to assess that whether or not internal control is effective. And directors, you know, have no objective basis unless they get an external assurance from external auditors. And you know how onerous the requirements are in the US, Sarbanes-Oxley Act, Section 404, which requires audit of internal control. So here, you know, there is a requirement for board to issue a statement that internal control is sound in design and effectively implemented. And it, very interestingly, our directors, almost in very large number of cases, I have seen this statement being modified in certain companies. And they don't give this statement, they modify it, and there is no problem. SECP doesn't, you know, insist on exact wording. But majority of the cases, people are giving this statement and without even carrying out a review. As I said, in UK, when this requirement came, the directors were reluctant even to, you know, they raised the question that how are we going to carry out this review? And they actually, then the regulator asked the Institute of Chartered Accountants in England, Wales, to do something about it, and they then established this famous Turnbull Committee, which has issued a guidance for directors, how do they carry out a review of internal control. So there is a comprehensive guideline in UK, which is famously called Turnbull Report. So my recommendation to the directors is that at least they should use that guidance of Turnbull report for carrying out a review before issuing that statement, and probably, you know, modify this statement rather than giving this type of statement, which is mostly without any basis. Directors' remuneration is a very hot topic, especially in the Western world, and most of the corporate governance issues, you know, in the West after 2008 crisis was that the executive remuneration, on executive remuneration and directors' remuneration. In Pakistan also it has now started to attract a lot of debate. For the first time, I think there is improvement. Some principle-based guidance has been given in the code, which is a good guidance. But I think the principle-based requirements on remuneration introduced, but following aspects are missing, which should also have been included. First of all, I think it is important that the director's remuneration, there should be a requirement, should be approved by the annual general meeting. Because directors should not be able to remunerate themselves. Also, there should be a comprehensive requirement for disclosure of remuneration, including those of individual direct board members and directors. So therefore, from those aspects require further guidance. I think this is very interesting, and perhaps this is where immediate change is required. Hashmi Saab, it's very, in a way it is against the spirit of the company's ordinance also. Some amendments were incorporated actually into 2002 code also. And this is with regard to the initialed accounts. Now I am personally against this concept of initialing. This is probably only prevalent in Pakistan, very unique, and it creates a lot of misconception. And these requirements in the code, and also the SECP has also issued this guidance, frequently asked questions, which is making it even more confusing and against the law, what the SECP has explained. So the requirement is, it says for 6 months and annual financial statements, the requirements for the CEO and CFO is to present the financial statements, which is fine, endorsed by themselves and initialed by external auditors. Okay, this is still acceptable, although I think it should not have been in the code. In FAQ attached with the code under question 52, it is stated, in terms of requirements of the code 2012, the audit committee or the board of directors can only approve duly reviewed and audited accounts respectively. Now what you are basically saying is that the audit committee and the board cannot approve the accounts unless they are initialed by the external auditors. Duly, and they are using the word duly approved, reviewed and audited accounts. So it means that audit report, you see, accounts, unless and until auditors issue their review report or audit report, it cannot be deemed as reviewed or audited. Initial doesn't mean anything. It is very clearly specified whenever the auditors initial the accounts that initial is for identification purposes only. And many steps, important audit steps are outstanding, which are highlighted to the board. Like for instance, confirmations may not have been received. Certain things may be outstanding, and board approval is sought. Under the company's ordinance, it is very clearly stated that auditors have the powers to make inquiries from the directors. It is the directors who prepare the financial statements and approve the financial statements. And auditor's job actually starts after the financial statements have been approved, you know, the real job. But because of the timing that you have to do it in all 2 months, 3 months, so the field work is started simultaneously. But that doesn't mean that, you know, the requirement here, the frequently asked questions say that unless it says that in terms of the requirements of the code 2012, the audit committee or the board of directors can only approve duly reviewed and audited accounts respectively. which is against the law. So I think this is creating a lot of confusion. This needs to be immediately